So what I wanted to do today was give you just kind of an overview. Most of you, when you think of dogs, probably think about the dog you have or the dogs that you're close to. What is it like to think about dogs across dogdom, across that diversity that exists? And that's what we're going to talk about today, is really the genetical perspective or the perspective of a biologist looking at canine diversity and what that says about the genetics of canine evolution. What I have over here are some concepts that I won't talk about directly, so I'm going to try and use half the time to kind of give you that overview, and then we can use the other half of the time to talk about whatever you want to talk about, either from what I discuss or what's up here on the board or what questions you might have. So let's start with what we all share in common, a fascination of dog biology. Many of you know that the domestication of the dog and the diversification of its breeds is probably the grandest experiment in all of biology. For thousands of years, people just like us have evolved the dog into thousands, 1,000+ strains and breeds and subpopulations that we have today. Those breeds differ in dramatic ways for size, like what you see here between a Great Dane and a Chihuahua. They differ profoundly in shape and body plan, like the differences you see here between an Ibethan and a Mastiff. And if you're a biologist who studies the development of form, this says something very profound about the blueprint of a body plan. For instance, you never end up with a Mastiff body and a Sighthound head, or vice versa. So there's accommodation, there's attenuation, there's integration, and these are principles in developmental biology that we're not learning from studying fruit flies and nematode worms, for example. So what are the genes that sculpt these body plans? Now, one of the things that we clearly know is that all dog breeds today are descended only from the wolf. And so what we're looking at when we think about evolution, the evolution of the dog, is natural variation that's arisen spontaneously, driven through mostly artificial selection, selective breeding by people like us. And through that, we've sculpted all of these different breeds. And to give you an example that the size and shape differences that we see that are breed specific are truly a part of the developmental program, this is a picture of a purebred dog a few weeks after birth. So see if you can, in your mind, guess what this dog's going to look like when it's attained its adult form. So this is a few weeks later. This is the Jack Russell stage. This is a few months. And this is the adult form. So this is a Whippet. So clearly the genes that are driving size and shape that define breed differences in dogs are genes that are acting in development after birth. And again, that's a unique opportunity for developmental biologists. So clearly, through selective breeding, we haven't just changed the size and shape of dogs. We've also altered their athleticism and their physiology. We've bred dogs that excel for speed, like the racing greyhounds. And of course, we've bred dogs that excel for endurance, like the Iditarod sled dogs. And to give you a sense of just how extremely different these dogs are from all other dogs, they eat for us what would be the equivalent of 70 Big Macs every day, run over 100 miles in sub-degree temperature, and they do that 10, 11 days straight. So their physiologies, which are not, that's not just a consequence of training, though obviously they're well-trained, they're genetically bred to perform that kind of behavior. Now, a lot of people, when they think of these dogs, the racing greyhounds and the Iditarod sled dogs, they think really just about the athleticism. What they might not know is that both those breeds also have a behavioral drive to run fast or to run far and pull. In the case of the racing greyhounds, they're sight hounds. They chase things that are running away from them. So they love to do this lure coursing. Right? So if ever you're at a racetrack for racing greyhounds, they're actually chasing something. They're not racing each other. They're chasing something around the track. In the case of Iditarod sled dogs, these are drafting dogs. These are dogs that somehow derive gratification from drafting or pulling. That's the reward for them, is performing that behavior. So again, we've got genetics that not only have adapted their physiologies to these athletic challenges, But we also have genes that serve as a drive or motivation for them to perform these behaviors. Also, through selective breeding, we've cultivated very specialized talents and behavior. We have retrievers that retrieve, pointers that point, and flushing dogs that flush. Some of these dogs can do multiple things, but clearly through genetic and selection, we've specialized these behavioral attributes that clearly go back to the wolf. So in other words, these all have behavioral antecedents in the wolf that through selective breeding, we've strengthened and augmented. So what are the genes that drive those? This is a German shorthair pointer running through a field, and there you can see it hit the point. Now, there's a lot of training involved, there's a lot of experience, but this is driven by genetics. And what you probably don't realize is as that dog runs the field, it's using its nose to search the landscape for a scent emitted from a bird. And when it detects that scent, it locks up. So again, what are the genetic variation? What's the genetic variation that distinguishes this dog from other dogs that don't point like this? And what does that tell us about the way that behavior is set up in the mind? So we've also created breeds that perform work that helps us, and even very specialized work. So in the case of the Border Collie, this is a breed that uses finesse and intimidation to herd sheep. Contrast that with the Australian Shepherd that uses physicality and toughness to herd cattle as well as sheep. And then you have the New Zealand Hunaway, which is really the jack of all trades that can get in there and be close to the sheep without scaring them. Again, these specialized behaviors are driven by genetic variation. So we'd love to know what that variation is and use it to inform on how behaviors set up in the central nervous system. So to give you a sense of the instinct, this is a Border Collie. This is a champion dog. This is an older dog. So what you're going to see here is the combination of talent, innate talent, but also training, experience, and real-time handling by the handler up in the corner. And what you're going to see is this dog's using very characteristic behaviors to herd sheep. It's got that low predatory stalk. It occasionally will fall to the ground. It's showing strong eye. That intimidates the sheep. That clap right there when it falls to the ground is thought to release pressure. So the dog's taking commands from the handler up there in the corner to handle those sheep. So the dog also has to be very in tune with the handler. So this is a young puppy. This is actually the git of that dog you just saw. This dog's only a few months old. Clearly this is not an adult, so there's going to be playful activity. But what you're going to see is the dog clearly has an interest in the sheep. Not all dogs would. And it clearly has an interest in almost controlling the sheep. And watch what the young dog does here. It performs that clap. Almost no other dog in other breeds would exhibit that behavior. That's not a learned behavior. That's not a trained behavior. That's clearly genes that are driving that behavior. So again, what are the genes and variations within those genes that are setting up these kinds of instincts in the brain? This last video here, this is another Border Collie, so same breed, but this is a dog that's been trained to do agility. I don't know if you know agility, but it's kind of a fun activity. It's almost like an obstacle course for dogs. And so the owner of this dog wanted to see what kind of instinct this Border Collie might have. And so she brought it to a ranch in Northern California. And the dog's about 6 months old, I believe. And again, it had never seen sheep. It had never worked sheep. And from the moment she arrived with her dog, that dog was fixated on watching all the other dogs get their turn. So again, there's an innate desire, an innate drive, an innate motivation. And what is that motivation? And clearly there has to be a reward to have instinctive behavior. So in other words, these dogs herd sheep not because they're going to get a food reward or a hug. They herd sheep because there's a biochemical reward for doing that. The performance of the behavior is the reward. So one could argue that the same kind of endogenous reward mechanism might be shared in common with addictions, addictive behaviors, gambling, alcoholism, drug abuse, that's hijacking that reward center. So again, we want to use the instincts to get to the basis of drive and motivation. So So far, I've told you the dog's a model for evolutionary biology. We can understand how gene variation has contributed to the radically different sizes and shapes and coat colors and coat textures that we see in dogs. We can also use behavioral differences across breeds to access the mechanics of the mind, how this is set up genetically. So the last part of the introduction really is the dog is a medical model. The dog naturally suffers all of the same diseases we do, both simple and complex. I've listed some of them here. The question just before we got started was about cancer histology. Dogs suffer all the same cancer histologies we do. Breed predilection tells us that some of those cancer histologies are driven by genetic risk. So obviously we want to understand what genes are conferring risk to those dogs. Dogs also suffer neurological diseases, neurodegenerative diseases. There's an Alzheimer's equivalent in dog, possibly a Parkinson's equivalent. There's a couple of different movement disorders, and certainly a Lou Gehrig's equivalent in dogs. Obviously, myriad metabolic disorders. Immune dysfunction is a major problem in dogs because essentially we've inbred at the MHC, which is a major cluster of immunological genes. That inbreeding at the MHC confers even greater risk for immune-mediated disorders. Cardiovascular disease, whoops. Even the classification of disorders that we tend to think are most human, mental illness, psychiatric disease, dogs also suffer these. The most obvious one that many people are aware of are anxiety-related disorders, phobias, for example, of storms, panic attacks. But there is even some of the more subtle ones, almost certainly. Yeah?
Are they unique among higher mammals, though, in having these human-type diseases, or are other higher mammals also subject to them?
Are dogs unique? I'm sorry.
In sharing these with humans?
Part of the reason we're aware that dogs share humans is because we've set up this parallel healthcare universe of veterinary medicine, where these diseases are diagnosed and treated. Certainly in any animal, you could have these kinds of disorders, and almost certainly they arise. Natural selection probably would eliminate a lot of them, but also we wouldn't know about a lot of them. And of course, with dogs, they attain an age beyond what they would probably be able to attain in the wild. And so we're seeing those age-related decline, that age-related decline. But I should, that's a good segue to mention, we have about 23,000 genes. Dogs have about 23,000 genes. They're the same 23,000 genes. And so when you identify a gene that confers risk in human for, let's say, a bleeding disorder, you can almost immediately know where the counterpart to that gene is in the dog genome. And of course, if you can go that direction, you can go the other direction as well. So if we identify a gene that confers risk for osteosarcoma, it's immediate in terms of getting on the genome browsers on the internet and finding where that corresponding human gene is. And so that really sets the stage for comparative medicine and comparative genomics. Last, I just wanted to mention, we know that breeds can differ by a factor of 2 for lifespan and longevity. Your big breeds tend to live 8, 9, 10. Your small breeds can live up to be 18, 19, or 20. Again, that breed predilection tells us that genes are driving those differences in lifespan and longevity. We have a very strong candidate for the pathway that's driving that, and it's the pathway that almost certainly contributes a lot to those size differences between big and small. That's the insulin-like growth factor pathway. But even in some of the big breeds, for example, they've been able to institute selective breeding programs and through selection extend lifespan. In other words, breed the dogs that either had parents that were long-lived or were themselves long-lived. And what that does is it moves the mean. So anything that responds to selective breeding has to have a genetic basis. So that tells us there's other genes, yeah. So the telomere, so there have been some studies. I think it's still not as solid a foundation as you would like it to be, but the telomere length, if my memory serves, does correlate with that kind of lifespan tendency. So there's simple assays that one can do to measure, and many of you are probably aware that aging is correlated at least with the shortening of the telomeres in the cells as we age. So yeah, that looks to hold true in dogs.
This is starting to get me upset.
Uh-oh.
Because from the ethical point, like, I'm thinking, well, if they're so similar to us in their DNA, then now they're going to be subject to laboratory testing and become lab animals. And I think you're opening a can of...
No, this is great. So let me address that now. So I don't want you to get upset.
All right.
But the beauty of this, and I think this might be... Let me show two slides and then I'm going to get to that, okay? This is an example of a naturally occurring disease in dogs that is clearly relevant to an obvious one in humans. So this is a German Shepherd. You can see the dog's losing coordination in its hind limbs. This is an advanced stage of that same, it's not the same dog, but it's an advanced stage of the same disease. And you can see that essentially the dog's paralyzed in the hind limbs. This disease, this neurodegenerative disease, is going to move forward. Ultimately, this dog will be dead and succumb to the disease within a year and a half or 2 years. Before the molecular genetics was known about this, this was called degenerative myelopathy, and it was in a number of different breeds. So it tracks back to a single mutation. All dogs with this disease, regardless of breed, have exactly the same mutation, and that mutation has since been found. And it's a mutation in a gene called SOD1. SOD1 is responsible, mutations in SOD1 is responsible for the largest group of human ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease in humans. Now, most Lou Gehrig's disease is not tied to family. It looks sporadic, spontaneous, but of the familial Lou Gehrig's, it's the same gene, okay? So the genetic mapping identified that this models the human disorder. The beauty is, if we can develop a medicine that helps these dogs, it likely would help humans. But the opposite is true as well, which is if we can develop a medicine that helps humans, it will help these dogs. So the entire, you know, paradigm here is that you study naturally occurring diseases in dogs in the same way that we study those naturally occurring diseases in humans. And we treat those diseases in dogs in exactly the same way we would treat it in humans. And the beauty of genetics is, and that basically says that there, all dog diseases are diagnosed with human diagnostics. They're treated with human medicines. That tells us that they really are biochemically equivalent and counterparts. We've created this healthcare universe that uses all the best practices from human medicine. We don't necessarily do as much research in animals and have that benefit human, and that's not because there aren't strengths of doing research in animals, it's because the money's placed in human, right? So almost all of the best practices go from human medicine to veterinary medicine. And I guess it's going to be a couple more slides till I get to this. The beauty of genetics is all you need to study the basis of these disorders is a sample of DNA. And we can now get that just like in humans from saliva. So there's no need for invasiveness. We don't create diseases in dogs. We don't need to. They're naturally occurring. And so the goal here is to help dogs. And if we can help dogs, obviously we can help humans. So one question is, well, why are the genetics of complex diseases simpler in dogs or more easy to study? And for that, you can look at select human populations like the Bedouins or the Icelandic, whose genetics are much narrower. So for example, all of the Icelandic people are descended from about 750 Vikings. And they have this Book of Icelandabok, which essentially is a genealogy that traces all the way back to that foundation. So if we looked at 10 women in the US with early onset breast or ovarian cancer, and we said, what do they share in common genetically? The answer would be nothing, because we're so diverse. Now, that doesn't mean that each one of them doesn't have a different genetic driver of that disease risk, but they don't share anything in common. But if we looked at 10 women in Iceland who could trace their ancestry back to a common founder, and also who had early onset breast or ovarian, and say, what do they have in common? Not only do they have mutations in the same gene, they have exactly the same mutation. We call that a founder effect mutation or an identical bidescent mutation. As you can imagine, it's easier to spot or map or detect that mutation when it's identical in all of your patients than when it's all over the place, when the genetics are much more complicated. Every breed of dog is simpler than even the Icelandic human population for genetics. In other words, if we looked at osteosarcoma in Great Pyrenees, there isn't going to be 10 different mutations in the same gene, or 10 different mutations in 10 different genes that drive the risk for that cancer. It's going to be a small number of mutations in a small number of genes, acting in an otherwise uniform genetic background. So that's the reason that that breed mapping, breed-based mapping of complex diseases is so much more powerful in the dog. So in human genetics, you might only have 3, 5, 10 select populations that offer those advantages. In dogs, we have over 1,000. Essentially, every breed is narrowly bred, and the genetics are homogeneous and give you that advantage. This is an example depicting dogs from different breeds based solely on their genetic readout at about 150,000 markers. And as you can see, there's 10 breeds listed up there, and every dog from every breed goes to where it should go. And this is the opposite of what you would have with ethnicity in human. In humanity, in human genetics, there's very little that distinguishes one ethnic group from another. Most of that diversity is shared across all of us. In dogs, it's the opposite. There's very tremendous differences that distinguish one breed from another. There's very little that distinguishes dogs within. This is what drives genetic mapping of complex diseases in dogs. Well, this was the slide I was trying to get to. This is so important. The day a canine researcher intentionally creates disease in a dog is the day that they're out of business, that they won't be able to do research anymore. It's so critical to have buy-in from the breeders and owners who happen to have a dog that's informative for a particular disease to voluntarily enroll that dog. And by doing that, it simply means you give us medical information on the dog and you provide a saliva sample or a blood sample. That allows us to do everything we need to do. So in other words, we do dog genetics the same way human geneticists do human genetics. But it's even easier, because if you're a human geneticist and you want to study, let's say, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis in humans, you have HIPAA laws and privacy concerns and genuine concerns about healthcare coverage, et cetera. In dogs, we don't have any of that. So the privacy concern alone is a huge advantage. There's another advantage to studying medical genetics in dogs over people, and that is that all of you know one dog year is the equivalent of 7 human years. So if we wanted to study an age-related decline in, let's say, Alzheimer's, or a genetic variance that conferred risk for Alzheimer's, we might have to track an individual over 20 years to know, did that genetic risk affect that patient outcome? In dogs, that 35-year window is compressed into 5 years. So if you want to think about genetic epidemiology or preventive medicine, giving medicine or a drug that counters that genetic risk, we can do this. We can do experiments, genetic experiments in dogs, not invasive experiments, to prove efficacy that you could never do in humans. Just the time frame alone wouldn't allow it.
When you say we, you're not talking about pharmaceutical companies.
No, and this is maybe a good... Yeah. So she asked, when I said we, am I talking... I'm not talking about pharmaceutical companies, and I'm not. The we is essentially dog geneticists. And, you know, up until recently, I was an academic. So I guess I'll give you just a little bit of background. I got my PhD in genetics in yeast genetics at the University of Virginia. I did a postdoc at UC Berkeley. I had a faculty position at Tiegen and Van Andel, two private institutes in the Midwest. And my wife got offered a job here, and so I'm the significant other here. So I've been doing dog genetics specifically for over 20 years, and all of that time was as an academic. So the we is really the field. Yeah.
Okay. So you're totally ignoring the fact that these experimentation goes on.
Well, let me address that head on. In the last 50 years, you probably know that the dog has been a model for drug development. Mm-hmm. But the dog is a model for in the pharmaceutical industry. The dog as a drug development model was only for toxicity testing. In other words, they bred dogs in laboratories and gave those dogs drugs before they could do human clinical trials to prove that the dog, there wouldn't be adverse consequences. That's not how this would go, right? The way this would go is you would use the dog as a patient model for drug efficacy. Did the drug benefit? Not did it have adverse consequences. Did the canine patient benefit from that medicine? Now, the pharmaceutical companies are probably moving away from animal testing for toxicity simply because it's so expensive. And now with cell-based assays, you can get a lot of the same kinds of results. But again, no academic would ever engage in those. I mean, it's just, you know, yeah. So the last point that I'll make is all of this is driven by technology. Somebody mentioned earlier, it seems like now there's kind of an explosion in canine genetics and genomics research. And that really is because in the last 10 and really in the last 5 years, there's been dramatic changes in the way that we can analyze DNA, namely sequence the DNA. So many of you probably remember the Human Genome Project in the late 80s and the 90s. $3 billion over 15 years, thousands of labs to sequence one human genome. Now I believe it's about $4,500 in 4 days to sequence a human genome. And so that's a huge technological tipping point in our ability to analyze DNA. Clearly, that same technology allows us to look at a canine genome as easy as we can look at a human genome. There's a major difference, though. A lot more human genomes have been looked at than dog genomes, and so the annotation of what's a gene, what's a functional part is a little bit different. That's still a little bit harder for us, but clearly that's driving all of this. So we had the natural advantages of the purebred dog and canine genetics. Now we can really take advantage of that with these technologies. On the left is a gene chip. This is really a way to kind of scan at points across the dog genome, and we really use that as a landmark or a proxy for everything to the left and everything to the right of that marker. The next is DNA sequencing. That means we no longer have to look at one point and infer what's going on to the left and to the right. We can look at the whole DNA sequence. There's a couple things that are still black to us that we can't see. Those are repetitive regions and things like that, but now we can see everything. And the last, it used to be, even just a couple years ago, you needed supercomputing power because these data sets were enormous, terabytes of sequence data, et cetera. Now you can outsource almost all of this to, for example, the Amazon cloud. And so it's really democratized our ability to use this technology. So again, the goal here is really genuinely to help dogs. If we do that, it will help people, there's no question. We want to come up with genetically guided medicines, genetically guided diagnostics that are going to improve canine health. Many of you probably know when you take the dog to the vet, I mean, these are highly educated, highly dedicated clinicians, but yet most of what they do still is immunizations and spay neuters, and that's because they really don't have the tools to get in there for these complex diseases and diagnose early, look at early intervention, look at prevention. And of course, with genetic epidemiology, that's where all of this is going, is personalized medicine and preventive medicine. So I re-say that here. Essentially, you can look at multiple human patients that have the same disease, but they're going to have unique disease drivers. We can now see those unique disease drivers and treat that. That's in human and in dogs. The goal is really to prevent onset, to detect earlier, to reduce the severity. I mean, these are all points of intervention. And of course, if you can begin to monitor across an individual's lifespan and constantly assess or evaluate that health trajectory, again, in humans and dogs, you can think about ways to improve it. And that leads, at some point, to a more integrated algorithm-based medicine. And there were some comments recently in the media about algorithm-based medicine that I think the physicians didn't quite understand. But essentially what you're looking at is instead of reacting to a patient's disease, you're predicting what may happen and you're trying to change that outcome constantly, continually. So again, if we think about a human lifespan of 100 years, that's difficult to do. If you think about a canine lifespan typically of 14 years, that's much more reasonable to do. So just to kind of summarize that, the dog's a model of evolutionary biology. The dog's a model of brain and behavior. The dog's a model for understanding the genetics of complex disease. And the last thing I just touched on is the dog is also a model for what we call translational research, using that genetic knowledge to improve patient outcomes through improved diagnostics, therapeutics, et cetera. Yeah. So it depends on the kind of disease you're talking about. And clearly, the only way to directly change the genetics of an inherited disease would be something like gene therapy. And that's not what we're talking about. If you imagine these 23,000 genes, each one of them, and this is a little bit simplistic, but imagine each one of them is defining a step in a complex pathway. That pathway might be to build bone. It might be to regulate blood glucose. It could be a lot of different things. But each step in those pathways is defined by a gene. Now, if you have a mutation in a gene that alters the flux of that pathway because you've changed one of the steps, that's what we can understand. First, what's the pathway that's been altered? And did that step accelerate it downstream? Did it stop it right there? What happened? And then based on that, you can think about targeting proteins defined by those downstream genes or proteins defined by those upstream genes to try and restore the flux through that pathway. That was really kind of the mantra of rational drug design in the 90s, and it didn't work because we really didn't have the knowledge base to do that. But that still is the goal, that if you can understand what genes are doing to pathways, you can ultimately come with a clearer plan to restore that flux through that pathway. Does that make?
By doing, like, what would you do to the proteins that are coded before and after a mutation?
A small molecule compound could go and knock something out, or it could knock out a repressor of that, so that. No. It's all small molecule, typical drugs, typical medicines. This is what typical medicines do. I mean, there are some that.
This therapy is acting on the proteins.
Right. Right. But that really is central to the entire biotech industry, that if you understand pathways and what those pathways are doing and how changes in those pathways are conferring risk, you want a small molecule medicine that can go in there and try to restore it. Now, you're right, you may never be able to prevent it, but you might be able to delay it, slow down the progression, reduce the severity,
I'm thinking of, something that can be relatable, like finding out someone carries, the gene for breast cancer, and then they, have...
Preventectomy. Right.
Yeah, but they still can't be like, I want to get rid of this gene that I have.
Well, so one could imagine drugs that would try to restore to that pathway, the BRCA1 and 2 dependent pathway. It's hard to imagine how you would do that, but you could imagine drugs that could protect individuals that carry those mutations, give more options. Right now there aren't any. And that's why preventectomies are more, is a choice. But that doesn't mean that there couldn't be. Lou Gehrig's might be an example. So what we know, or what we think we know about this SOD1 mutation in dogs that confers that Lou Gehrig's-like disease, is there are some breeds where having that mutation almost determines that the dog will get Lou Gehrig's. There are other breeds where almost none of the dogs, and this is still anecdotal, but almost none of the dogs with that mutation, because we can perform DNA testing, get that disease. So that tells us, and you could invoke that these dogs from this breed experience different environments than these dogs from this breed. But the simplest interpretation there is there's something genetic in that second breed that protects those dogs from that SOD1 mutation. If they have something genetically, in other words, a variant that these dogs don't have, without question, you could develop a small molecule that recapitulates or provides that same kind of protection, and then you give it to the dogs in the first breed. And if you can do that, then of course we can also give human ALS patients that same protective effect. Now, if you already are suffering from ALS, it might just delay it, it might slow it down, it might reduce the severity. But if you could identify individuals at risk, that's perhaps where you could make the biggest improvement.
What does this mean for other genetic diseases that it's hard for me to even contemplate having a cure for, like, you know, Down syndrome or dwarfism?
So each disease is going to have its different vulnerabilities or points of intervention. And the diseases you just mentioned, it's hard to imagine how you would reverse some of those effects because many of them take place very, very early in development. Obviously, you stand the greatest chance to change a trajectory in a late, you know, a later onset disease. But every disease is different, for sure. Yes. So that's the current paradigm for looking at those neurodegenerative, that you have an inability to eliminate or scavenge unfolded proteins, for example, that are toxic to those cells. Yeah.
Are there any diseases of dogs which are common across breeds?
Yeah. So those are the diseases that we really have not studied because it's not so clear or not studied successfully because it's not so clear that there's a genetic component to them. Examples would be epilepsy. Another is thyroidism, hypothyroidism. So these are diseases that you tend to see across, you know, almost across all breeds. So the example for epilepsy is probably clearest, and it might be that domestication has sensitized the dog's mind to idiopathic seizing, right? So all dogs are domesticated, so they all would be at risk for that. I mean, most breeds are also susceptible to cancer. What we see is the cancer histology, which seems to show a predilection. Yeah.
So do wolves exhibit the same diseases that the dogs?
No one knows because the wolves aren't kind of being brought into the veterinary healthcare. Right, so it's hard to track, but almost certainly, you know, you would imagine that wolves may share some of these mutations that are conferring risk may have originated in the wolf population, and there's been multiple introgression events right throughout all of dog domestication back to the wolf, but yeah, so I don't know. So early on, there was debate about when dog domestication happened, and there still is. But there was a paper that came out very early, probably 10 years ago, that suggested domestication happened 70,000 years ago, which didn't really fit with the archaeological record because you'd found humans buried with dogs, for example, 14, 15,000 years ago. Most, kind of the conventional wisdom right now is that there were two phases to dog domestication. The first was almost a passive phase where wolves domesticated themselves in the sense that those wild canids that didn't mind being around humans to scavenge refuse, for example, had a benefit. Their reproductive fitness was higher. They were able to have more offspring. And then in about 15,000 years ago, it changed to a much more active domestication where humans saw value in breeding and maintaining dogs. And that's when you had... Yeah, 15,000 years ago. I mean, I think most people would argue that it probably happened about the same time that we domesticated corn, for example, as we were starting to
corn dogs.
Right. One last thing, you asked about human. That I don't know. Millions, but what I would say is you do have to view the dog as one of the most evolutionarily successful organisms because it's throughout the world. I mean, everywhere we went, dogs went with us. We brought them with us.
That's what I was wondering. Were they domesticated in all the continents?
There's debate about that too, whether domestication happened once or whether it happened multiple times. The data right now suggests it happened multiple times. But there's probably been a lot of gene flow since, and that obscures the record quite a bit.
Specifically thinking about the quick forming diseases like brain tumors in dogs, and I wanted to know, does your research determine that it's always genetics or it's also environment? How do you know that there's a difference?
So I think almost always, as a geneticist, you're going to say, well, let me test whether genetics is involved first. And you really, you're not going to try to control environment because you'd have to, you know, have a controlled setting, which you're simply not going to have. But all other things being equal in the environment, if you see breed predilection or you see a particular bloodline predisposed, we certainly believe at that point are willing to test that there's a genetic component to it. If we can detect that genetic component and you can hold the genetics constant, now you have greater power to ask, is there an environmental component? So maybe a good example of this would be we've looked at obsessive compulsive, or what we think is the equivalent in dogs of obsessive compulsive disorder. So this is in the Doberman Pinscher, and these dogs exhibit kind of compulsive flank sucking and also acrylic dermatitis, which is they'll lick their paws until they have sores. And almost certainly there's an environmental component of boredom, anxiety. Anything that exacerbates that anxiety is likely to exacerbate the symptoms. We think we've identified three regions of the genome that are associated with that. And we interpret that as meaning that drive that risk. So if you can control that and then look at dogs that are in one environment and are high risk and in another environment that are also at high risk, now you can ask with greater power, what's the effect of that environment? So the environment we're really interested in testing in these Dobermans are those that stay at home and those that maybe engage in Schutzhund, which is an activity that demands a lot of training and attention, or agility, or any other activity that they might do with their owner. And so that gives us a chance to look at, but what you're not often in a situation where you can try to look at everything at once. So we always try to look at the genetics first. Right. Yeah, so on average, siblings are going to share about 50% of their genome. But it could be as little as none, and it could be as high as all. And so, really the important thing there is to look at how much sharing do they actually have and which regions are being shared. But that's kind of how we do the genetic mapping, is we're essentially comparing, let's say, 100 Great Pyrenees with osteosarcoma, and was to 100 Great Pyrenees that are older, maybe out of that critical window, that didn't get osteosarcoma. And we're saying, is there some region or multiple regions of the dog DNA that are shared at a higher frequency in this group relative to these controls than what we'd expect by chance? So the comparison you're doing between siblings is exactly the kind of comparison we do. But you generate those DNA profiles for all those dogs. And you could do that for siblings too, for instance. The wolf to wolf question, yes.
But my sister is a vet, so she sees how people don't want to pay for diagnosis and treatment. But do you think this is something, like testing would be something that actually become commercial? Testing people could see what kind of disorders dogs would have?
Yeah, so there's the status of the field right now is you can test for a lot of simple disorders. But a breeder or owner has to go to a lot of different places to do that. And on top of that, you know, so that can get expensive, not to mention that it's fragmented. On top of that, breeders and owners have difficulty assessing, so what does this really mean in terms of how I breed the dog? Right? So there's an absence of genetic counseling, if you will, or breeding counseling. But where this is going is you want to have one place where the owner can go, get the genetics, and not only have some professional advising, possibly through a counselor or maybe even a veterinarian or both, but also be able to anonymously or not reach out to other people who have dogs in a similar situation. So in human medicine, how this is being handled, or how this is kind of working, is you have organizations like Patients Like Me, where patients can self-represent and share insights and experiences, and that has a lot of benefit. Not the least of which is being a place where pharmaceutical companies can go to enroll patients in clinical trials. So one of the things we would like to do is create a similar kind of forum for dog owners and breeders so that they can share best practices and insights. And again, you want to be able to keep it anonymous, but that would be very helpful. And a key part of this is bringing the veterinarians into this. Yes. I mean, if you had a dog with a particular disease or disorder, I could almost guarantee some lab in the world is collecting samples to study the basis of that. And so almost all of the kits that are being used now are either simple cheek swabs, where you send a swab to the owner and they take the cells, the buccal cells, the cells of the cheek, put it in an envelope and send it back, or even saliva. Now, and if you were to take the 23andMe test, which is for us, for humans, you spit into a cup, seal it, and send it to 23andMe. In dogs, obviously, you can't get them to spit. You can collect saliva from some of them, but they make sponges. So you just stick it in the dog's mouth, it absorbs the saliva, put it in the preservative, and send it to the lab. So it's very simple. What doesn't happen, though, so I would say in the 20 years I've been doing this, we've probably collected over 50,000 DNA samples from 50,000, you know, dogs. Most of those, obviously, are healthy dogs, or at least were healthy at the time we collected the sample. What you'd really like to know is what happened to that dog. And that's also where kind of the informatics part comes in. We'd like to be able to follow an individual patient or an individual dog throughout its entire life. And there's great benefit to the research, but also to the health of that dog if you can do that. We don't, because they're more complicated, but as you identify more and more mutations, the mixed breed dogs actually can offer a lot. So one, I mentioned this earlier with the Lou Gehrig's counterpart, degenerative myelopathy. Once you've identified a mutation that has a measurable, detectable effect, you'd like to intentionally put that mutation in different backgrounds and ask, is there another interaction? Right? Are there mutations in other genes that maybe make it worse, or are there mutations in other genes that maybe make it better? And again, what you're trying to do is elucidate that pathway, right? And this is what you would do in mice, is you'd put that mutation into your different genetic backgrounds. Mixed breed dogs represent kind of a wild card, right? Because you're not exactly sure what the background is, though you could sequence the dog. But you could, if you could find mixed breed dogs with that mutation, that might be a way to map modifiers, what we call modifiers. So right now, no, because we're still too simplistic, but at some point, that would be of great effect. One of the things that we didn't talk about is what I would call recreational genomics in dogs. I think it's important to say this, and it's the fun part, right? The dark side is the medical genetics, but there's an amazing part of dogs too. And one of the things I was at UC Davis Vet School for 6 years, and I was shocked at how almost all of the clinicians, by the time they graduated and left, were so focused on health only. But I can't imagine that you become a veterinarian because you're not fascinated or amazed by the biology of these animals. So, for instance, the herding instinct that we see in border collies or the pointing instinct that we see in pointers. And beyond that, the question of personality in dogs. I mean, there's no question that what you might call personality in dogs has a genetic component because we clearly see temperament differences that are breed specific. There's just no question. I mean, you could hear somebody describe a terrier to you and you'd be like, that's a terrier. So, you know, there's a whole nother set of things that we would love to understand that we think could actually help bring the owner and the dog closer together. So an example would be, you know, you have a five-year-old child and the five-year-old child comes home and says, I want to play Suzuki violin. I love music, I want to, that's great. That's a desire, a talent, an aptitude that if they didn't tell you that, you wouldn't be able to support them in doing it. Dogs have talents like that as well. And just like kids that engage in those kinds of activities, there's a reward, there's gratification, there's a benefit to doing that activity. And so if you knew, let's say, in a mixed breed dog that the dog's a pointer or has pointing genes or has a love of water like a Newfoundland, this might kind of inform on the kinds of activities you and the dog would do together. So I think there's a whole nother part to this, just like 23andMe with the recreational genomic side, that is there to engage breeders and owners and have a real positive influence. Any other?
What kind of dog do you have?
There's none. So as you can imagine, as a scientist, and I'm sure there's other scientists in the room, you tend to work pretty long hours. And so we were just talking, and I can tell you every 6 months in every new project, there's been a new dog I've wanted to have. So how many people here have dogs? So what kind do you have a mixed breed in the back? Yeah. Do you know what kind of?
One of them is border collie and something else.
Shepherd lab. So are you guessing that or did you actually have a test done?
We had a test done with the shepherd lab.
Okay. Was that the MMI Mars? So I mean that's a question we've had is, you know, there is a test now that'll inform on ancestry. Just like 23andMe, you can get a sense of the different lineages that go back. And Mars has said, well, if you understand the ancestry of your dog, it can change the way you give that dog health care. Well, the truth is, what you really want to understand is not does that dog have German Shepherd. You want to know, does that dog have the SOD1 mutation that is enriched in German Shepherds? And so the beauty of ancestry testing is really, as a company, you can never be wrong. Because how can anybody prove that it isn't 40% German Shepherd? But in terms of actionability, it doesn't carry a whole lot of action. But I think that the success of that test reflects just how fascinated, intrigued, interested the owners are in wanting to understand their dog better. I mean, it really becomes part of the family, and I'm sure all of you with dogs know that. So even though it's not actionable, it's fascinating to know. Yeah.
Well, so what is the difference in the genetic variability between two dogs and the two different breeds?
So two dogs from the same
breed.
Yeah, two dogs from the same breed. So I'm a little bit outdated on this. But I want to say two dogs from the same breed have a variant that distinguishes them about one every 1,000 letters of DNA, one every KB. Two dogs from different breeds have a frequency about one, you know, one variant that distinguishes them about one every 500 or 600. So again, the variation within a breed is low compared to the variation between breeds. In humanity, it's again the opposite. You know, there's very little that distinguishes ethnic groups, for example. There's some, but very, very little. It's very modest. But within any given ethnic group, there's a lot of variation. I mean, the anecdote 10 years ago, and I don't know if it's held up, was there's as much diversity in any village in West Africa as, you know, entire countries in the world, because of course that's where humanity originated. So. Well, so humans have the same diversity of all dogs if you just threw all dogs together, right? It's about the same diversity. So the idea is that as humanity originated in Africa, it was there for a long time. It acquired a lot of genetic variation. And then as groups migrated out, those groups were large enough to pull most of that variation with them when they left. So as they carried it along, it was propagated. And there's probably people here who are even can give a more articulate answer to that, but that's the idea.
Are there ethnicities in dog breeds?
Well, essentially you could make, so I should say ethnicity, let me back up. The director of the NIH, maybe we should turn off the camera for this, came out, you know, I don't remember, 7 years ago or something, and said, genetics has disproven, you know, ethnicity. And what he was really saying is, again, there's very little genetics that distinguishes an ethnic group from another. The problem with that statement is ethnicity was never a genetic construct. It was a sociological or a demographic construct, right? So I would not want to equate ethnicity with dog breeds, because dog breeds clearly are a genetic construct. Now, what you call a breed is not so clear. So, for example, by the modern definition, which has only existed for about 80 years, in order to be a purebred dog, you'd have to be the offspring of two registered purebred dogs. But obviously, it didn't start out that way, right? So throughout most of canine history, it was very different. Breed was defined based on how you looked and how you acted, and that was it. And there are a couple of breeds that still do this. The border collie, they don't care what you look like. They just care that you behave and work like a border collie. So they can have what's called an open registry, because if you work like a border collie, you're a border collie. Now, I've never seen a pig work like a border collie or a Dalmatian or anything, but. So we refer to that as a geographic subpopulation, and we refer to the problem as what we call stratification. So imagine, you know, a lot of the breeds that are popular here now in the U.S. were breeds that maybe originated in France or England, or so you had the, let's say, the French version, and then you brought over some dogs here, and for the last 100 years we've been breeding them here, they've been breeding them there. The French don't like us to take dogs back, because they prefer their style, right? So for 100 years, they've been bred, you know, to different ways. And so the genetics can be quite different. And I'll put it to you this way. We can look at one of the DNA profiles from our Illumina array, and it's very clear, is this an American dog or an English dog or a French dog? But it depends how long they've been separated. It depends on, was the type similar that they were breeding to or different? And that's happened too. And it depends on a lot of things, just how different they can be. But once you've separated the breeding demographics, they take off on independent trajectories.
So then epigenetics becomes more important.
No, I wouldn't say no, because the genetics can still be important. And even though you have a purebred dog, I can tell you, you know, every once in a while the dog hops, you know, the next door neighbor's dog hops the fence. So there's intentional introgression, there's intentional changing of the gene pool. So a lot comes into play. But you bring up a good point, which is epigenetics, which we've not talked about at all. And I think epigenetics could actually be responsible for some of the interesting traits we're looking at, even some of the behaviors. Because one of the things we've never understood is why, when you create, let's say, a purebred border collie that exhibits those very clear behaviors, and then you remove selection, why do those behaviors dampen? Why do they not? And this is only anecdotal, but they don't appear to stay robust. And so, you know, if this was genetically fixed, there's no place for those variants to go, right? So it's possible that epigenetics is going to play a much greater role in this, much to my disappointment. But sorry, somebody else.
So dogs have behaviors such as pointing and herding, and what are analogous human behaviors like that you say, like she has and I have, or they don't have, or you know what I mean? Like,
I'm not a human biologist, but as a human, I can tell you an example would be handedness, right?
What?
So handedness.
Oh,
I mean, I'm right-handed. Other people, it's probable that, you know, that genetics play a role in that asymmetry, right? Our handedness goes back to the asymmetry of the brain, and almost certainly we know there's pathways that create asymmetry. There's a gene in mouse. When you knock it out, half the mice have the heart on this side, half have it on this side. So handedness would be an example of a simple behavior that dominates our daily life that probably is influenced by genetics. And dogs appear to have.
So when you say a different group, like the Irish are this way, or the Italians are
I would never say that.
That's not like, so that couldn't be analogous to breed behavior, because it's not a breed construct, is what you're saying?
No, I mean, the only thing I would call a breed-based behavior is something that appears to be, the only thing I'm interested in are breed-specific or breed defining behaviors, because it alerts us to the fact that they're probably genetic. That's the only reason that it attracts me, because I want to understand what the genes are, how they work in the central nervous system. How do you hardwire an instinct? How do you reward that instinct? Right. So this is also worth saying, we could care less about the actual gene. The gene becomes a window into that process. It's a foothold into the process. Same with disease. It doesn't matter what gene it is, it matters what the pathway is, because there's going to be a lot of genes that are important. But it gives us a foothold into understanding that.
Could you talk more about the epigenetics?
I could, but I'm not a trained epigeneticist, so it would just be probably a lot of you have read as much, if not more, in the scientific journals about epigenetics than I have. But epigenetics is relatively new, and I think we're on the cusp of seeing that a lot of things are influenced. We already know, for example, cancer is very much influenced by the epigenetic mechanisms, no question. But I think we're going to find that a lot of things are influenced by epigenetics that we didn't know. I'll tell you one that I find really interesting in dogs that's still uncertain is, in humans there's something called charge syndrome, and it's caused by a mutation in a gene that's influenced that influences epigenetics. And it's a syndrome because it involves multiple effects, but not every patient's going to have the same, right? And charge, each one refers to one of those effects. Dogs get charge syndrome, except they typically only get one. So an affected dog's only going to have one of those. So that could be a really interesting way to try and understand the human disorder and the dog disorder, because they're going to be different, and we can learn from the differences as well as the things that they share. So that's one of the few things that I said, wow, I really would like to understand more about epigenetics and how it might relate to that. I know that didn't, sorry.
So this was a really fun talk.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.